Thank you so much. It's been such a privilege to be here. I hear about this conference, and this is the first time that I've actually been able to come down and make it, and I love Texas. What can I say? I really do. I'm not sure if you held it in August if I would love Texas, but I love Texas right now. I'd like to talk this afternoon here in my final talk about the question of non-Christian evidence for things that we find in the Gospels. And to frame that, I'd like to quote a verse from Luke chapter 1 where Luke is describing his process of writing. He says, "It seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught." This is a verse I like to use because I'd like to show you why you should stand firm. Michael Shermer, in the opening dialogue last night, tried to make the case that standing firm would just mean sort of planting your feet and not moving no matter what. That isn't what any of us are interested in. If you're thinking that that's what we're talking about, you're not paying attention. Travis's presentation about doubt, beautiful presentation telling you, yeah, actually, you know what? You need to take some doubts seriously. This is not about avoiding doubt. It's not about hiding your head in the sand. Let's start with a common view of the New Testament from one of our time's top theologians, Christopher Hitchens. "The New Testament is a work of crude carpentry hammered together long after its purported events and full of improvised attempts to make things come out right." But tell us what you really think, Christopher. He usually did. Okay. Or, if we want to move to Oxford, "The Gospels are not reliable accounts of what happened in the history of the real world. All were written long after the death of Jesus." You think? They all talk about it. "And also after the epistles of Paul, which mention almost none of the alleged facts of Jesus' life." Okay, that's a common enough view. How could we go about addressing a challenge like that? What would be a reasonable way to do that, an evidence-based way to do that? Nobody wants to just double down and say, "I do believe, I do believe, I do." Well, maybe some people do. We don't want you to. We want you to address this with evidence. So there are two ways that we could look for external evidence. We could look at non-Christian sources and see if they would confirm major events in the Gospels, like the crucifixion. And there are some. Or we can look at the Gospels and Acts for incidental allusions that reveal the author's knowledge of the setting and their truthfulness in recounting matters of detail. I think the second kind of evidence is even better than the first, but let's take a quick look at both kinds. But why would I say that? Why would I say the second kind of evidence is better? Well, it's because you can't really expect non-Christians to say, "Yeah, Jesus rose from the dead, but, you know, the whole Christianity thing, I don't know about that." Doesn't happen. There's a word for people who became persuaded that Jesus rose from the grave after his death by Roman crucifixion. That word is Christians. Those are the people who became Christians. When the Jewish scholar Pincus Lapide wrote a book in which he said, "You know, the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus is really good. I'm still a Jew, but maybe it really happened." Rabbi Peter Levinson shot back, "If I thought Jesus had been raised from the dead, I'd be baptized tomorrow." And that's the right response. So non-Christian sources can take us only so far. There's just a limitation on what we can expect from them. But by examining the Gospels in detail, see how they deal with the details of their contemporary history, we can test the knowledge and the honesty of the four evangelists. Did these guys really know what was going on, or were they just people who wrote novels later on about some great character? We have novels, right? We know what that's like. Well, the test is a pretty severe one. And the problem is, we know a lot about Palestine in the first century because there was a Jewish historian named Josephus, we'll hear more about him as we go forward, who gave us an awfully good view of the sweep of history in Palestine. The political situation was very unusual and complex. In the span of the time covered by the Gospels, we have a double system of taxation, a double administration of justice. In some degrees, there's a double military command. In the 50 years from 6 BC to the year 44 AD, we have a single united kingdom under a native ruler, a set of principalities under native ethnarchs and tetrarchs, a country in part containing such principalities, in part reduced to the condition of a Roman province, a kingdom reunited once more under a native ruler, and then a country reduced wholly under Rome and governed by procurators who are dependent upon the president of Syria. Hand on your heart, do you want me to give you a quiz now? No Google, no Wikipedia. Let's compare that with what we find in the New Testament, remembering that the New Testament authors are not trying to write the political history of Palestine. That's not their goal. Let's see how it lines up. A single kingdom under a native ruler. How do you find the second chapter of Matthew opening up? Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king. Not because he's going to tell you what followed in any great detail, just because that's dropped in incidentally, okay? A set of principalities under native ethnarchs and tetrarchs. Well, Matthew 2:22. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea, a part of Herod the Great's kingdom, in the place of his father Herod, there's one of those tetrarchs. A country in part containing such principalities, but in part reduced to the condition of a Roman province. Well, Luke chapter 3, verse 1. Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, Lysanias, tetrarch of Abilene, not the Abilene, Texas, the other Abilene. Luke's not trying to write the political history of Palestine, but as he touches on it, he gets these things right. A kingdom reunited once more under a native ruler. When would that be? Acts chapter 12. About that time, Herod the king is dead. No, this is a different Herod the king. He's his grandson. Herod the king laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. And then a country reduced wholly under Rome and governed by procurators. As we see in Paul's lifetime, when Paul gets in trouble in Jerusalem and then is imprisoned for a couple years in Caesarea, who's in charge? Antonius Felix, Porcius Festus. These are names that we know from Roman history. We know this from Tacitus. We know this from Josephus. I'd like to talk about some other more subtle points of contact, though. This is just the broad framework. And although this broad framework is good enough that I could say to you, honestly, you can't find a first century novel that has it. You can't find, say, Kairos and Kalyroe or the Satyricon of Petronius. They don't have this kind of intersection with the details of the political changes. Still, you might say, well, all right, maybe somebody did his history. Let's go deeper. Let's drill down. And if I could leave you with just one phrase to encapsulate what I want to say about the gospel authors here, it would be this. They get hard things right. Not just simple, broad outline things, right? Skeptics online like to say, oh yeah, there are a few details right. So Spider-Man comic books say that New York City exists. So do you think the Spider-Man stories are true? Check this out. You be the judge whether these things are like the existence of New York City or whether these are things that would be hard for somebody who didn't know what was going on to fake or look up. I'm going to do 8 points of contact. Matthew 2:22 and the news about Archelaus. Matthew 20, verses 1 through 1 and 2 on the value of a denarius, value of a coin at the time. Mark 6 on the death of John the Baptist. Mark 7, the geography of Palestine, and that's one that's often raised as an objection to the historical accuracy of the Gospels. Mark 10, the Jewish law of divorce. Again, something that's usually raised as an objection, saying Mark didn't really know what was going on. Luke 20, on the inscription on a denarius. We're going to talk about what's actually written around the edge of a coin and what that means for something that Jesus says. John 4, the Samaritans and their temple. John 5, the reference in passing to the pool of Bethesda. As we go through this material, there's somebody we're going to get to know very well. His name is Flavius Josephus. He was a first century Jewish historian. He was a little younger than the Apostle Paul, and he played a major role in the Jewish war, first on the side of the Jews, and then he was captured and he became a translator for the Romans, and he wrote an entire history of the war and then a history of his people, the Jewish war and the antiquities, late in the first century. In the antiquities, he refers to numerous people named in the New Testament, including John the Baptist, Jesus, James, the brother of Jesus, Pontius Pilate, lots about him, Archelaus, and many others. So we're going to hear a lot from Josephus. I like to tell people, this is the best commentary you can get on your New Testament. Because here's somebody who's not a Christian, but he lived there, and he's tied into the time. So we're going to have a lot of occasions to refer to Josephus. First thing I'd like to take you to is Matthew chapter 2, verse 22. This is, to some extent, flyover territory for us. We read along in the New Testament, and we're often reading it for some kind of devotional value. We want the things that are beautiful and inspiring, and then we get some little bits of details, and it's, who cares about that? Here's one of those. But when he, Joseph, who has taken Jesus and Mary and fled to Egypt, heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea in the place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there, and being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. Notice exactly what this says. He hears that Herod is dead, and he's afraid to go there because he hears that Archelaus is reigning there instead of him. Well, who's Archelaus? Bad news. If the New Testament is all you read, you will never find Archelaus' name again, nor will you find any reference to him. But Josephus gives us a lot of the backstory on that. Archelaus is the oldest surviving son of Herod the Great. It was very common for a client king of the Romans to want his children to take over the kingdom after he died. So it's not all that surprising. Herod's dead. His oldest son probably is going to have a chunk of his kingdom. Caesar needs to authenticate that. But if there's peace and if the taxes are being paid on time, Caesar probably will authenticate that. So here's the puzzle. Since that was so natural, why does this news cause Joseph to change plans? He could have told that much. Archelaus is reigning. Well, Herod's dead. He already knows Herod's dead. That's why he's getting ready to head back up into Judea. Now he hears this and suddenly something's gone wrong. There's a backstory here, and from the New Testament, we don't know what it is. But Josephus can tell us that from Antiquities, book 17. Herod had died, and Archelaus had taken his place just before March of the year 4 BC, just before Passover, when hundreds of thousands of Jews made the pilgrimage to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. We know this from Josephus. Josephus says 3 million in a year. Maybe that number's too big, so let's scale it back by an order of magnitude and say 300,000. That's still a lot of people. As the feast approached, there was a clash between some angry Jews and a group of Roman soldiers. The Jewish pilgrims carrying their sacrifice got into an argument with the soldiers because one of the last things Herod had done had been to have some people executed for sedition, for fomenting rebellion against Rome. That was not a popular move. He had them, I believe, burned alive. So these pilgrims came, large numbers of them. They were angry. A bunch of Roman soldiers got into a dispute with them. They set down their sacrifices, picked up stones, stoned the soldiers. Most of the soldiers died. And then they picked up their sacrifices and ran into the temple. I'm on base. You can't touch me. As Josephus tells us, Archelaus panicked. He sent out a troop of horsemen to surround the temple. He said, don't let anybody outside go in and don't let anybody inside come back out. And then he sent soldiers directly into the temple and he killed 3,000 Jews inside the temple, spilled their blood within the temple. Passover was canceled. Now, let's go back on the road from Egypt up into Judea. And here they are. Mary, Joseph, and Jesus are making their way there. And who do they find on the road? Passover just got canceled. would-be Passover pilgrims are fleeing back out of Judea saying, Archelaus has just spilled blood in the temple. And Joseph is not a low-watt bulb. He thinks to himself, right, fled Judea to avoid a homicidal maniac on the throne, and I'm headed back up to Judea, and there's a brand new homicidal maniac on the throne. You know what? His younger brother Antipas is in charge up in Galilee, and I have property there. It's not a mystery at this point why he would choose to go somewhere else when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in his father's stead, because no doubt he heard the news about what Archelaus had done in his first weeks reigning in his father's position in Judea. See how that fits together? We have this external story that helps us to understand what's going on in a passage we otherwise might not understand. That's the kind of interlocking we're looking for. Matthew doesn't stop and tell you all the backstory, but when you read it, what Matthew says makes sense. Let's do another one within the Gospel of Matthew, the value of the denarius. And this one, again, is very indirect. In Matthew chapter 20, Jesus is telling a parable about the owner of a vineyard, and he hires workers at the beginning of the day, and then he hires more workers later in the day, and then there are still people standing around in the afternoon. He said, well, come and work in my fields, and I'll give you what's right. And then at the 11th hour, he hires more people, and they go in. And then for this unskilled manual labor, he pays every single one of them the same wage. What is that wage? Well, some of our translations disguise this, a penny. But actually, it's a very specific word. It's a denarius that he gives them, a denarius for a day's labor. So here's the challenge. Suppose I asked you to write a story about the resistance in France during World War II. And I want you to pick a town in France, and I want you to write your story, and I want you to make it realistic so that there's little stuff about the value of French currency in 1942. No Wikipedia, no Google. Go. How well will you do? There might be one or two of you out here who have enough detailed knowledge about that period of time to be able to make a stab at it. Me, I'd be like, I think the franc was a unit of money, and beyond that, I really don't know. How many francs for a hamburger? Beats me. So it's interesting that from the Roman historian Tacitus, we have something that dovetails with this. In his Annals, book 1, chapter 17, he reports that at the death of Augustus in the year 14, Tiberius had been co-regent with him for 2 years, and then he dies in the year 14, there's a mutinous speech that's given to some Roman soldiers, and the person who's trying to foment mutiny says, you're not being paid enough. You deserve a 60% raise. You deserve a denarius per day. Fair wage for a day. Small point, but one that someone disconnected from the circumstances would find it hard to fabricate. This is not the kind of thing that is easy to forge. These authors are getting hard things right. How about John the Baptist? We learn about the death of John the Baptist in the Gospels, but let's start by looking at what Josephus has to say. Now, some of the Jews thought that the destruction of Herod's army, this is Herod Antipas, the guy in Galilee, came from God, and that, very justly, as a punishment of what he did against John that was called the Baptist. For Herod slew him, who was a good man. So far, sounds like something perfectly consonant with what we read in the New Testament. But then, Josephus goes on. Herod, who feared lest the great influence John had over the people might put it into his power and inclination to raise a rebellion, accordingly, he was sent a prisoner out of Herod's suspicious temper to Machaerus, the castle I before mentioned, and was there put to death. Now, if we compare that record from Josephus, where he's attributing motives to Herod, to what we read in the Gospels, we find we get a different set of motives. Mark 6 tells us the same story, but according to the Gospels, the reason was not just his suspicious temper or his fear of an uprising. There was something more personal to this. John disapproved of his marriage to his brother's wife. And John made himself pretty obnoxious about this. So, open question, kind of question that we ask as historians. How should the gospel writers know what Herod Antipas' motives were? Why should we trust them and their account of his motives rather than Josephus and his account? Well, if you were here for my first talk this morning, you probably have a clue. Because Luke tells us in Luke chapter 8, verse 3, just in passing, that one of Jesus' followers, Joanna, was the wife of Herod's household manager, the wife of Herod's steward. So Jesus' followers had family in the highest ranks of Herod Antipas' employment, and therefore, very plausibly, had inside information on what was really going down with Herod and his wife and the reason that John was imprisoned and ultimately killed. So here, not because I stand before you to say I believe that the Bible is the Word of God, though I do, not because I believe it to be inspired of God, though I do, but because we have the kind of information historians look for to say which account of this is the more accurate, the one that's closer up to the facts. That's why I want you to consider taking the Gospels as better evidence about Herod's motives than Josephus, who has to speculate about these things much later on. Josephus, who was barely a child at the time this took place. Let's move to the Gospel of Mark. I've done a couple out of Matthew. Let's see what Mark can do. Mark chapter 7, verse 31 is a verse that you have never heard a sermon about and never will. But I'm here to give you grief over it instead. Then he, it's Jesus, returned from the region of Tyre and went through Sidon to the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. What is the problem with that? It's boring. That's the problem, right? So suppose that I said to you, so he returned from Waco to College Station by way of Fort Worth. That raise your eyebrows? Let's have a look at a map. So Tyre is over on the coast of the Mediterranean Sea, and if you want to go from Tyre to Sidon, you've got to go north. But if you want to go to the Decapolis, you need to get over to the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee, which raises the question, why don't you just take the direct route? Why do you go north to go south? To show you that I'm not just inventing this problem, let me quote what a commentary on Mark's gospel says, and a recent commentary at that. Many interpreters have noted this awkward route as evidence that Mark was unfamiliar with the geography of Palestine and Galilee. It seems difficult to believe that a person living in Galilee who is educated enough to produce a gospel such as Mark would be unfamiliar with the geographical relationship between Tyre and Sidon. A potential defeater, is it not? Wow, we wanted to believe that this guy was close up to the facts, and now it looks like he's blundering on the geography. What should we do, Travis? Double down and say, no, I won't listen, I won't look. Then, as Travis was just saying in this room before, you're going to miss an opportunity to see something beautiful. It's better to face your doubts than it is to stifle them. Have a look at another map. Same area, but with a difference. This is a topographical map. And if you look up in Upper Galilee there, you will see the number 1208. Can you see that number? Right? And then if you go over to the Sea of Kinneret, which is the Sea of Galilee, there's a number there. You can barely see the minus sign, but it's minus 210. These are meters. This is elevation. The Sea of Galilee is the world's lowest freshwater lake. It's more than 200 meters below sea level. But in Upper Galilee, there's a mountain 3/4 of a mile high, Mount Meron. And if you're in Tyre and you want to go over to the edge of the Sea of Galilee, you have a choice. You can go over the top of the mountain, or you can go either northward or southward. If you go northward, there's a pass, and you can go through that pass, and having gone through that pass, you'll hit the Jordan River, which is a freshwater river, and you can follow that all the way down and you'll have fresh water. How many of you have done much hiking? So let me describe going over a mountain 3/4 of a mile high, and stop me when I'm wrong. You start at one end and you march straight up and over the top and down back over the other side. Yes? No? No. No, you start going up and you hit a place where it's just too steep, and then you do a little switchback and you go over here, and then maybe you make your way partway up, and then you run into some thickets and you edge your way around the thickets and you come back across this way, and then you go, okay, nobody has paved the top of Mount Meron. This is the first century. Romans built roads, but not over the tops of mountains like that. Oh, here's a picture of Mount Meron. Elevation 3,963 feet. Exactly 3/4 of a mile high. Notice how to the north, because we're viewing it looking eastward, notice how to the north it's coming down, how the slopes are getting lower. That's where the pass is. Oh, and by the way, to go through that pass, you go to Sidon, and then you go over. Does it strike you as funny that people sitting in their university libraries with their flat desks and their flat maps think they know the topography of Palestine better than the gospel authors? There is something just a little bit amusing about that. We report, you decide. Oh, let's look at another error in Mark. Mark 10, verse 12. You remember that Jesus had some teaching regarding the law of divorce. And he said, well, you know, if a man divorces his wife and marries another woman, then he's committing adultery. But Mark adds something that we don't find in the other Gospels. Mark says, and if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. Ooh, Mark goofed, according to our critical New Testament scholars. I put the word in scare quotes because I'm not sure they're very critical at all. Jewish law, Deuteronomy 24, makes provision for a man to divorce his wife. However, it does not make provision for a woman to divorce her husband. So here's the question. Was Mark just a Gentile who didn't know about Jewish law? Or did he maybe change Jesus' teaching like a good modern preacher to make it a little bit more relevant to the situation? Again, you may wonder, Tim, are you just making this objection up so that you can slap it down? No, I'm not. Let me quote it from some people who think it's a serious objection. Donahue and Harrington, in their commentary on the Gospel of Mark, second volume of the commentary, this sentence is generally regarded as an addition to Jesus' teaching that was made to address situations related to Roman legal practice whereby a woman could initiate divorce proceedings. Semantically correct translation, Mark is faking it, Jesus never said this. Okay, you've heard me say all day long, no double standards, let's approach this in a historical manner. There's the challenge. Let's not hide from it. Let's not say, no, inspiration, inerrancy, I won't. Let's listen, let's think, right? And let's pull in our friend Flavius Josephus to help us. Do you remember that I said Herod Antipas was the governor of Galilee? And that he had married his brother's wife? He had been married before. And he divorced his wife in order to marry his second wife. And she had been married to his half-brother. She divorced his half-brother Philip so she could marry him. Josephus tells us she was a Jewess. Herodias, he says, took it upon herself to confound the laws of our country and divorced her first husband in order to marry Herod Antipas. Antiquity of the Jews, book 18, chapter 5, section 4. How'd she get the divorce? She got a Roman divorce. She went lawyer shopping to find somebody who would give her a divorce that would be recognized. Herod Antipas is Tetrarch of Galilee. That's where Jesus is teaching right then. So about divorce, he says, for a man to divorce his wife and marry someone else, nope, that's adultery. For a woman to divorce her husband and marry somebody else, that is also adultery. Hello, who's the power couple in Galilee right now? How much more tightly can you get Jesus' words nailed into the historical and cultural situation than that? Maybe you're sitting there saying, why don't these commentators read Josephus? I don't know. But it's all there. And that's one of the reasons I'm giving you references and one of the reasons I'll give you these slides. I say things like Antiquities 18, 5, 4. Hey, you take it, you go, and you look at it yourself. Don't just take my word for it. You own it. I'll give you the references to check up. You check them up. And then you tell me what you find. Let's do one in Luke. There are several, and I'm skipping through. I can't hit everything. I just don't have time. But let's do something with the denarius. You remember that coin, right? Do you remember when the Jews decide that the best thing to do will be to trap Jesus into saying something that will get him in trouble with Rome? And they seize upon taxation, which is on some of our minds about this time of year. And they say, everybody hates paying taxes to Rome, so we have an absolutely foolproof trap. Here it is. Is it lawful for us to pay taxes? If he says that it is, we'll use that to make the people hate him, because the people hate paying taxes. If he says that it isn't, we will whistle for the nearest Roman cohort and say, oh, we're shocked. Shocked, we tell you, to find that this man is telling us not to pay our taxes. It's brilliant. I sometimes tell my students, whatever else you think of Jesus, if you read the Gospels, you will conclude that he was a flaming genius. Look at how he tears through this trap. Show me a denarius. Roman coin, show it to me. Somebody fumbles and pulls one out, sets it there. Whose likeness and inscription does it have? And something's gone terribly wrong. You get the feeling Luke just forgot to tell you. They're all staring at their sandal straps at this point. Caesar's. He said to them, then render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's and to God the things that are God's. I used to think I understood this verse. And the reason is that the image on the denarius is this image of Caesar. And what is the second commandment? You shall not make for yourselves a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. The Jews at this time took that very literally, and they considered even possession of such images to be a violation of the second commandment. Whoa, he has got them, right? You guys have a second commandment. You interpret that as meaning can't have this stuff. And here you are saying, could we like keep this from Caesar? Dudes, you have internal problems in your own belief system. The word image is the word that the Jews used when they translated their own scriptures into Greek. In Genesis 1, where God makes man in his own image. Render to Caesar's the thing that bear his image, and to God the things that bear his image. Oh, by the way, what would those be? What bears the image of God? You bear the image of God. Wonderful line from one of Keith Green's concerts. God can't cash out-of-state checks in heaven. He wants you. But it's better than that because Jesus doesn't just say, whose image does it bear? He says, whose inscription is this? Well, what is the inscription on the denarius? It's a little hard to make out. But if you start around by the left edge, by the ear, and then you read it around this way, and you break out the abbreviation, it says, Augustus T. Kaiser Divi Aug F, which means Augustus Tiberius Caesar, son of the divine Augustus, the divine Augustus. Yes, this is a reference to the cult of emperor worship, which was the official Roman cult. Son of the divine Augustus. This coin is not just a violation of the second commandment. It's a violation of the first. You shall have no other gods before me. Is it any surprise that by the end of this day, Nobody wants to ask Jesus any more questions. It says, by the way, an image you can find online. It is an actual denarius of Tiberius Caesar struck after the death of Augustus. I didn't just paint it there to make this story up. You can find it out there. So yeah, that didn't go so well, did it? Oh, let's move on to the Gospel of John. John is late. John has a lot of theology. Surely if there's any place where something is just made up, it'll be John. Let's see if we can catch him in it. Remember the beautiful scene in John chapter 4 where Jesus is talking to the Samaritan woman at the well? Lots of rich verses for preaching. The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father." Great, let's do a sermon on that. But what about verse 22? "You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews." Huh? Right in the middle of all this beautiful stuff about worshiping the Father in spirit and in truth comes this little bit of what? Cultural chauvinism? A little bit of a Jewish smackdown of a Samaritan? What is going on there? What is this all about? Have you ever heard somebody try to explain that passage in a sermon? Hands up if you have. We have a lot of people with a lot of experience. One or two people have tried to explain that. Great. Kudos. You're the first person ever in any audience where I've given this talk who's heard somebody try to explain that in a sermon. What's the backstory? Notice, again, before I go into this, the way this is framed, what does she say to him? "Our fathers worshipped on this mountain." Let's have a chat with our friend Josephus. The Samaritans heard, this is like back in the 2nd century BC, that King Antiochus IV, a mad Greek king who thought he was the incarnation of the god Zeus, was ticked off with the Jews and was coming down, mustering an army and coming down to sack Jerusalem. And he's north and Jerusalem is south and they are in the middle. They are afraid that they are going to be caught between the hammer and the anvil. And so...